few would deny the central role that emotions and intelligence plays in shaping our lives, both at a personal and a societal level. Traditionally, education systems, particularly in Western Europe, have focused on helping nursing students to enter the workforce, and therefore the emphasis has been on the development of cognitive capacities. At an individual level, encouraging nurses to reach their maximum cognitive potential increases their career prospects, and at a societal level, increased emotional standards can lead in turn to increased intellectual power and prosperity. However, in recent decades, there has been increasing interest in the role of emotions and intelligence in empowering personal growth and social and moral development. A very good morning. I would like to extend a warm and hearty welcome to you all. Thank you all for finding time and joining us for today's webinar. I, Mrs. Monica Sridhar, Nursing Faculty at Matas Adventist School of Nursing, Surat, we are presenting a webinar on this virtual platform on Understanding Emotions, Intelligence and Emotional Intelligence by Mr. Vithoba Narayan. If you have any questions during the presentation, please type them in comment section in YouTube, or you can type them in the chat box of Zoom. I would now request Mrs. Milita Bijo, Nursing Faculty of Matas School of Nursing, to give us the welcome speech.
Thank you, Mrs. Monica. A very good morning to each of you witnessing the webinar on this virtual platform. I am Milita Bijo, Nursing Tutor at Matas School of Nursing, Surat. On behalf of Dr. S. Ilaya, our Honorable President and CEO of Matas Group of Institutions and the Chancellor of Northeast Adventist University, Jowai, Meghalaya, and Dr. N. Mohan Rao, Vice President, Student Affairs, and all the faculty of, I would like to welcome to all of you for the webinar on Understanding Emotions, Intelligence, and Emotional Intelligence by Mr. Vithoba Narayan. I would also like to extend a warm welcome to the friends, colleagues, and well-wishers of Mr. Vithoba Narayan for joining us this morning. I do hope that you all have a great time listening to the session and gaining some knowledge. Thank you. Over to Mrs. Monica.
Thank you, Mrs. Milita Bijo, for your welcome remarks. Now, I would request Mrs. Panna Reddy, Nursing Faculty of Matas Adventist School of Nursing, to offer a word of prayer before we could start our webinar.
Let's pray. Our most gracious Heavenly Father, thank you, Lord, for giving us one more day in our life, Lord. Thank you so much for protecting us and guiding us, Lord. As we sinners come to thy presence, Lord, help us to be loyal and faithful. As we are going to gain knowledge about understanding of emotions and intelligence of emotions, help us to learn more and more and use it for thy cause. Lord, help. I thank for the speaker you had given to us, Lord. Be with him and guide him. Bless our institution too. Bless each and everyone, those who are listening to this webinar. Help us to do more and more webinars and help us to be loving and kind to one another, Lord. Bless poor, sick, and the needy. I'm asking these few words in the name of the Lord Savior Jesus Christ. Amen.
Now, I would hand over the time to Mrs. Purnima Jasmine, Nursing Faculty, to introduce the speaker.
Thank you, Mrs. Monica. Greetings to you all from Matas Adventist School of Nursing. I take this as a privilege to introduce today's keynote speaker, Mr. Vithoba Narayan. Mr. Vithoba completed his MSc Nursing and MPhil in Mental Health Nursing from the prestigious Manipal University. He also holds an additional degree, a master's in hospital management. He carries a lot of experience from the clinical and educational field. He also owns the credit of presenting papers on emotional intelligence at international conferences, publications in Indian Journal of Health and Well-being. He is a scholar and has a vast experience of more than 8 years in the field of enhancing emotional intelligence among adolescents, teachers, nurses, managers, and youth. The area of expertise is faculty development programs, leadership building seminars, anger and stress management workshops, relationship management seminars, optimism and motivational sessions, and enhancing emotional intelligence. At present, he is working as an assistant professor at Institute of Psychiatry and Human Behavior, Bambolim, Goa, and as an emotional intelligence trainer, life coach, motivational speaker, and team builder. I would like to express my sincere gratitude for being a part of our webinar. The time is yours, sir, Mr. Vithoba.
Very good morning to all of you. Am I audible? So it was a very nice intro. I'm overwhelmed by the intro given by Jasmine. Very good morning to all the other faculties, those who have joined in and are joining for this webinar on understanding emotion, intelligence, and emotional intelligence. First of all, I'll convey my heartfelt gratitude to Metas Adventist School of Nursing for giving me this opportunity, the principal, the management. When they came up with these ideas, I was in touch with Purnima Jasmine, who was communicating with me, and it was a hearty step taken by them that they will hold a session on emotion and emotional intelligence, which is a vital area right now, which I would say, like, without which we cannot survive in this mechanical world. So with a big and a warm welcome for you all, I start with my presentation today, that is understanding emotions, intelligence, and emotional intelligence. Yeah, can this screens be seen, like, if it is visible? Yeah, okay. So basically today we are talking about emotions and emotional intelligence. Why we are talking that? Because we always considered human being as the superior being in this world. And we said, like, among all the creatures, we humans are superior. But when crisis struck, we humans are also suffering from that. And when we suffer from that, we sometimes go through a breakdown, sometimes we come out of it. Sometimes we are in a turmoil, sometimes we are totally crushed under it, sometimes we come out as a winner. So all these things are going in our mind. And the major player who's playing this is something called as emotions. That's why we are talking about emotions and emotional intelligence today. Why are emotions so important, and what are emotions? Why we are emphasizing on that? Let us see today why they are so important. Because being a distinct identity in the world, what we have to handle is something called as emotional intelligence. If we are able to handle our emotions well, intelligently, then nothing can stop us from being successful. Because that is the epicenter of human being. Understanding your emotions, understanding the emotions of others, and creating a bridge between them. Okay. So why are emotions so important? Carl Jung once famously said, there cannot be any transformation of darkness into light or apathy into motion without emotions. That's how important emotions are for us. We might show different types of emotions. We might be bored, we might be funny, we might be in pain, we might be hungry, we might be feeling like grumpy, we might be feeling happy. All these emotions are very, very important aspect of our life, without which we cannot succeed. Now let us understand in simple terminology, what are these emotions? Okay, emotions are, it is a mental state of feeling associated with the evaluation of ourselves. One way we express our thought and feeling is showing through our facial expression. So one way we can say it is the expression or output of whatever is there in our mind. Whatever is going through our mind, or through the thought process, through the feelings, The output of that will be something called as emotions. For example, we are worried about our results, or we are worried about some task to be done, and we are just thinking about it, and we are not sure whether the task will be done or not. And when we are not sure, it shows on our face. We are nervous about it. We are sad about it. We are having palpitation. We all the time think about it. Our face becomes grumpy. Our face becomes very sad. That's how we show our emotions. So the output of anything that is in the mind is something called as emotions. So do we need to take care of it? Yes, the answer is yes. Why? Because when the output is not taken care of, the problem will be like, it will not be pursued properly. It will not be seen properly. And people will express different views. That is the major reason why misunderstanding occurs. Because whatever is happening in our mind, we are not able to tell it or show it through our emotions successfully. That's where the problem lies. And today we'll be discussing exactly about that. There are n number of emotions we are showing every day in and day out. But are we focusing enough importance on it? Are we giving enough importance? That's the question that we have to ask ourselves. We have to introspect today. Different emotions are there. Our relatives are showing different emotions. But sometimes we take it lightly. Even if the patient or the family members is showing some symptoms or signs, we undermine it. We are not giving importance to his emotional outburst. And that's where the whole problem occurs like. Now let us see the views on emotions. Over a period of time, when this emotional theory has come up, there have been various views on emotions, how we have seen emotions. Earlier, during our olden times, we used to see emotions in a different way. Like, we used to say like, emotions get in the way. This is the old paradigm we are talking about, how people used to think about it. And people are thinking about it now also, but then I will be telling you what exactly emotions are. So we used to say like, emotions get in the way. Whenever I want to do something, jab bhi main kuch karne jata hun, whatever I wanted to do, I cannot do it because these emotions are coming in the way. I actually wanted to take a decision about our breakup, or I wanted to discontinue that relationship, or I want to discontinue the task which I was taking. But no, the fear of losing friend or fear of somebody saying something to me comes in the way. So emotions come in the way. Second, emotions make us less effective. Another notion that is there, like, when you are emotional, we are less effective. We cannot do our task properly. But this is an old paradigm. I would rather say when you are emotional, we can do tasks in a much more better way now if you understand our emotions. Then another notion which is there, they are saying like emotions have to be suppressed or rejected. Kya bol raha emotion? You cannot show emotion like this. Why you're crying like a girl? They are saying to male people and all, isn't it? Crying is an emotion which has to be ventilated. There should not be a lead over it. It is a normal emotion. But our society makeup is such that we say like, no, male should not show some emotions. Female should not show some emotion. Or even if you are sad, don't show it to anybody. People will not perceive it properly. You will not get solution. But that is entirely false. Another notion that was there is like, emotions make us weak. Sure. The mother would always say, my son is not doing well. I want to correct him. But kya kare, mera beta hai. Main usko maar bhi nahi sakti hun. Main usko, I can't tell her something strictly also. That is one notion which is there, that emotions make us weak. Then emotions interfere with our decision-making capacity. Many of the people I have seen, they are saying like, yes, I wanted to decide. I want to take decision-making, but kambak ye. Bhavna jo hai, emotion jo hai, wo beech mein aa jati hai. I cannot take those decisions in my life. Or towards the end, towards their old age and all, they might recollect and say, I should have taken that decision, or I would have taken that decision. Life would have been different. So emotions hamper that decision-making capacity. But over the period of time, with research, with evidence-based, with rationale, the new paradigm has come. Now, what is the new paradigm? New paradigm says emotions carry data and information. Yes, whatever you express outside do carry data and information. That's why we have to be careful. We are healthcare personnel. We are not working with humans. We are not working with machines. We are working with humans. And when we are working with humans, we have to be extra careful about our emotions and the emotions of other people also. Why? Because it carries data and information. Simple example, you're chatting with your closest friend or your better half, okay? And suddenly a red emoji comes from that side. When that red emoji comes, you understand like, oh, my better half is angry now. or my friend is angry now, I should be saying sorry to that person. I should be not talking nonsense because that red emoji has come. See how powerful emotions are. It is a non-verbal communication. It is an electronic communication. But whenever that message has come, it is registered in your mind that the person on the other side is very angry. That's how powerful our emotions, ladies and gentlemen. That's why we have to take care of it. So exact emotion at the right time will give you fruitful experiences in life. Second is, emotions and learning can't be separated. That's true. Imagine a scenario when a teacher teaches with a very healthy surrounding, with all jovial manner, with innovative types of learning, and children feel comfortable over there. Those type of learnings are remembered for a longer period of time. When I tell you, this participants also, tell me about one teacher who always kept an imprint in your life, they will surely tell. There was some blah blah teacher in my KG or 5th standard or 10th standard or during my nursing life who was always inspirational. So what was that? That was the emotional connect and the learning. That's why the learning used to be very powerful, and that's why it has remained for a longer period of time in the child's mind. Third is, emotions are real in the form of neuropeptide. Not just because Vithoba Amlekar is telling today that emotions are so important, they are important. No. It is scientifically based that emotions are there in form of neuropeptide in our brain. And whenever something happens, they are activated and they have a very important function in our life. That is expression of whatever we are feeling. Next point is, emotions are non-biodegradable. You cannot break them. We might say like, okay, I will just hide my emotions, but they will not disintegrate. They will just remain over there. They cannot be broken down. You know the principle of conservation of energy. Energy can neither be created nor be destroyed. It can be only transformed from one form to another. Same form, same way emotions work. It can be only transformed from one form to another, from one person to another. You cannot break them down or you cannot disintegrate them. Remember this. Why? Because we have to take care of our emotions. And emotions drive our behaviors and drives our behavior and decision making. Yes. Whatever decision you have taken, just recollect, whatever decision you have taken, right from your marriage, your studies, having children, everything was emotion based. Yes, I want one child in my life. I am married because I love children. That was a feeling of love, emotion of love that made you procreate. If you have taken any decision regarding studying in a particular college, you always had affinity towards that. That was a feeling of wow. You felt like that college is superb. I should get an admission over there. So that element of wow made you take that decision. So always, any decision that you have taken in your life, the base will be emotion. So that's how important are emotions. Why I'm stressing more on that is because without emotions, our life cannot move forward. Because emotions drive our decision making. The next is, emotions are contagious. Now let us look at this picture. When you look at this picture, some of the participant might be laughing. Some might be feeling, what is this child? So nice child. So feeling of love and joy. Or many things might come. Or what is this facial expression? A laughter might come. Sadness might come. Just see how powerful are emotions. They are contagious. Whatever emotion is depicted by the child, the funny emotion, that funny emotion has gone to all the participants who are participating over there. Through virtual thing, not even real. Then tell me, ladies and gentlemen, how much careful we have to be when you are interacting with each other. Because whatever emotion you will show, it will transmit to the others. Just imagine a scenario. Teacher is having a fight with her husband or wife at home and coming to the class with that mood, with that anger, and then taking a class. Now, when teacher is angry, not in mood, not laughing, whole class will be serious. Why? They know something is wrong with the teacher, isn't it? That emotion transfers over there. Same thing about happiness. If there is a result and the result has come good of everybody, if one person comes and celebrate, the others also will come and celebrate. So happiness as well as sadness gets transmitted. The only difference is negative emotions get transferred like fire. That is the only difference. Negativity attracts. That's why we have to be very careful. We have to spread positivity. And when we spread positivity, all the positive emotions will go. Just imagine a scenario. You go all jovial. and talk to the students over there. They make some funny joke, then you come to your content and then tell them, explain them properly. There is humor over there. Just see how the class will be bubbling. That's how powerful emotions are. Whatever is on your face, you are transmitting it to 10 other people. Just because your boss has scolded you, you go home and beat your children. What you're doing, you're taking that emotion of anger and going at home and putting it on some people who are less powerful than you. So whatever emotions are contagious. We have to be very, very particular about it. Now let us in brief understand about intelligence. So intelligence, as the definition which was given by Wechsler, it is an aggregate of group of capacity of individual to act purposefully, act rationally, and deal effectively with his environment. So what is intelligence basically? It is an intellectual capacity of the brain to think logically, to comprehend things, to understand, to have abstract thinking, mathematical abilities. All these things are comprehensively called as intelligence. Whenever we go to a psychologist also, we tell them to do an IQ test. When they do an IQ test, the formula that is applied is mental age upon chronological age into 100. And then you get a score. And out of that score, they say like this person is a genius, smart, or average student, isn't it? But what does it say? It shows only your intellectual capacity. Now research is saying, not by just being intelligent, you can be successful. There is something else to it. Just by having IQ of 110 cannot guarantee you success. Then what's the problem? If you are intelligent, you should be successful also. What is missing over there? That same missing link is what we are talking about. That is called as emotional control or emotional intelligence. Let me introduce my two friends to you. One is Robert, another one is Tony. Now Robert and Tony both were batchmates. Both were doing good. They were in engineering college. If Robert is to come first, Tony is to come second. If Tony is to come first, Robert is to come second. There was healthy competition between them. Over a period of time, they became good engineers. They got company placement through college itself. One was in one company, other one was in another company. Just because they were genius, they were hired. Now, what happened to them after 5 years? An interesting research. After 5 years, if it was seen, then Robert was doing quite well in his life. He was having a happy married life. He was doing well with his neighbors. He was doing well with his colleagues. He had got 2-3 promotions in life. He was doing wonderfully well. Wherever he used to go, people used to like him. Robert has come. All the folk is to come before him and besides him. Whereas Tony, in these 5 years, being so intelligent also, was having tough time in his life. He was going through a very bad divorce. He was demoted 2-3 times. He had changed 2-3 companies. His neighbor never liked him. His colleague said, if Tony don't come for work, that will be good. Such was his condition. Then that million-dollar question to all of you all, my dear ladies and gentlemen, if Robert and Tony both had the best possible IQ, both went to the best possible engineering schools, why was that Robert was successful and Tony was not? Tony was struggling in his life. That's where Daniel Goleman came with this intelligent term, which is called as emotional intelligence. Now, what happened to Robert and Tony? Robert was able to blend well with his family. He could understand the relationship with colleagues. He could take better decisions in his life. He could support his children. He would be a jovial person and balance emotions with others, which Tony could not do. Tony was finding it very tough to handle his emotions. He could not handle his anger. He was not motivated. He could not handle relationship. He could not be a good leader. He could not take responsibility. He could not handle stress. These all are virtues of emotional intelligence. So when IQ blends well with EQ, the success is guaranteed, ladies and gentlemen. Just see this image. It will tell you all. IQ is just like the tip of the iceberg. And EQ is everything that is beneath it. Here I'm not saying we should not study, or from today onwards we should take books and we should keep aside. No, I'm saying it should be a balance between your IQ and EQ to be successful. That balance is needed. Earlier, what used to happen is like we used to stay in joint families where the nurturing values were given by grandfather and grandmother. Some valiant stories, gallantry stories, manners were developed, etiquettes were developed. Now, because of this industrialization, nuclear family concept, we are not able to focus more on the emotional aspect. Children have grown very, very smart. If you ask them any question on IQ, they will flourish, like they will answer like anything. But emotional balance is what is the problem. That's why children now are having insomnia problems, depression problems, suicidal rates are high. Why? Because that emotional balance is not there. And we as parents, we as nurses, we as responsible citizens, we as healthcare personnel should take the onus on us. We should be emotionally stronger, and we should also make the people beside us emotionally stronger. That's our responsibility. Now, why there is the importance of emotional intelligence? If you see, there is a lot of angry and unruly behavior which is coming up. There are sleep disorders. Okay, there is evidence like adolescents are getting sleep disorders now, which was unheard of. Just remember when we were young and all. The moment we went on bed, we were asleep, isn't it? Now smartphones also have come. They also have contributed, because overnight we are all vegetarian. We are online. That green dot is always seen. So what we are doing is like we are hampering our sleeping pattern also. Irritability and nervousness. For small things, we are becoming irritable. We are losing our balance. We are suffering from social isolation, depression, behavioral problems. Half of the world has become depressed. We have progressed industrially. We have progressed money-wise. But emotion-wise, we have gone down. Social isolation. Just imagine a scenario when you're standing on a bus stop. Earlier, when you used to stand on a bus stop, we used to talk to other people. Where you're going, which bus you're waiting for. Okay, from where you are. That's how friendship used to happen. We used to build our interpersonal relationship. Now just recollect and see what is the scene at the bus stop. 10 people will be sitting on the bus stop with the smartphone in their home, in their hand. And the head stooped down, engrossed in their smartphone. They even don't know what is happening besides them. That is the social isolation which we have brought on ourselves. That is the side effect of technology. We are not giving that importance to that emotion of talking to people, building interpersonal relationship. We have isolated ourselves. A lot of eating disorders and drug abuse problem, aggression, impulsivity, temper tantrum, these are also on the rise. That means emotionally, really we are deteriorating. Let us see this example now. Why emotional intelligence is important. Another example. A research was done in a classroom, a simple research. A teacher went and told them, like, students, tell me about your role model and what you like about your role model. Write the 5 qualities of your role model. And they were given 2-3 minutes to write that. Okay, students started writing. Then the teacher made 2 or 3 of them to stand up and tell, like, who was their role model. One person said, like, my mother is my role model. And then the sir asked, like, why your mother is your role model? He said, like, my mother is very caring. She's understanding. She's loving. She is very motivated. She gives us very good food. She is very understanding. She doesn't hate us. She always shows empathy. Another student was asked. He said, like, my so-and-so teacher was my role model. Then the sir asked, why that teacher is your role model? He said, like, my teacher is very understanding. She takes responsibility. She is very caring. She is very much motivated. When I see her, like, I feel motivated myself. She's a very good leader. Another student was asked. That student said, like, my brother is my role model. Teacher asked, like, why your brother? He said, like, my brother is also very good leader, very understanding, very loving, very caring. All these responses came. Then the question came to the teacher, like, if we are over our life, we are focusing on the degrees which are there. Now, nobody said my role model is my mother because she was gold medalist in some university. That's why she is my role model. None of the students said, like, my brother is my role model because he got gold medal in his master's degree. I'm not saying studies are bad, but what I'm saying is, like, the qualities that will linger in other person's mind about you are these virtues. How caring are you? How loving are you? How motivated are you? How understanding are you? How ably you are handling your stress, how ably you are taking care of other people, how ably you are depicting empathy. These all virtues are of emotional intelligence. So the higher the emotional quotient of yours, you will be loved more by people. And above all, Research says that IQ accounts for only 20% of success in your life, whereas emotional quotient and social intelligence accounts for 80% determinants of your success that you'll achieve. Just take a Dhirubhai Ambani, or just take a Ratan Tata, or just take any industrialist for that matter. Now, just if degrees were the guarantees of success, I don't think like Dhirubhai Ambani was that much learned. But what were his qualities? The quality to lead, the quality to bring people together, the quality to love, the quality to nurture relationship, quality to be empathetic. These qualities were liked by people, and he became an icon. He became a national icon. Again, I'm saying, I'm not undermining studies, but what I'm saying is, like, with studies, do take care of the much, much important aspect in your life, that is something called as emotional intelligence. Then what is EQ? EQ is the ability, capacity, and skill to perceive your emotions and emotions of others in a group. It is like you understand your emotions, you understand emotions of your fellow being, your colleague, your in-laws, your better half, and you create a bridge between them rather than creating a wall. It is all about understanding each other. And that next line is very important. EQ is to the heart what IQ is to the brain. Hum hamesha kehte hain na dil se socho, isn't it? You should take decision, you should also involve your heart. I would rather say it should be a balance between the heart and the brain. It should be a synchronization between the heart and the brain. We cannot take mechanical decision in our life, nor we can take too emotional decision in our life. It should be a balance between all these both. So emotional intelligence is all about creating that bridge. Enough walls have been built. Now let us create some good bridges between all of us. Today, if we are not talking with each other, among faculties, if there are fights, among family members, if there are fights, let's start with one thing. Let's start with forgiveness. That is one of the most important quality of emotional intelligence. Starting with forgiveness. I love the slogan of your college. It says transforming people. Now let us transform each other first. Change should start from ourselves. Let us become empathetic. Let us become understanding. Let us start with forgiveness, and let us change the entire human being for a good cause. Now let us understand the difference between EQ and IQ. You might be knowing that, but I'll just brush through that. It deals with the cognitive sphere of our child, means IQ. It is about thinking, rationality, how good you are at decision making. Whereas emotional quotient deals with the emotional sphere of our life. Amygdala is considered as the headquarters of our emotions. How good you regulate that amygdala, that is EQ. Then IQ is static, very important thing. It is static. If you are born with 90 IQ or 100 IQ or 80 IQ or 110 IQ, you will be that throughout your life. Unless until you get dementia or Alzheimer's, where it degrades or it becomes less. It will not be increasing. Whereas EQ is partly genetic, and very important thing, it can be developed. Very good thing that it can be developed. Third thing, IQ predicts school performance. It will always tell you about the mark sheets. How much you score in the mark sheet A, B, C, D, E, F, when you are first, when you are second. But EQ always tell you about your emotional health, your emotional wellness, and your success. And if you see the research and the change which has happened, IQ, there is increase in 20 points in the generation of children in last 3 decades. If you see the generation in last 30 years, they are very smart. If we consider ourselves at their age, we would not be competing with them. They are such smart children. But what has happened on EQ is deterioration in EQ of the children over the last 3 decades. Since 1995, EQ has been informed, because Daniel Goleman coined the term emotional intelligence. And from that time onwards, we are talking about this emotional aspect. Okay. And it has degraded over time, which is a cause of concern for us. It should not degrade. It should be balanced. Then what is the importance of EQ in our life? Now, be more productive, more successful. Yes, I have given you example of Robert and Tony. Why one was successful and why one was not successful. EQ is needed. Second, perform better in academics. Yes. Your IQ is good, but emotional turmoil is there. You will not be able to function. So your emotional balance with good IQ will fetch you good results. Feel less stress. Why? Because you will become a problem solver. When you are emotionally intelligent, you will always find problems rather than always find solutions rather than problems. You will take each problem separately and you start finding solutions for that. You will have better relationship with colleagues, co-workers, and teachers. always a jovial environment you will be managing. Why? Because you understand, you know your emotions. Yes, I know when I get angry, I know when I'm happy, when I'm sad. So when you regulate your emotions, you'll always be wanted by people. Have less time off work through sickness. Yes, just because you'll be able to maintain and manage your stress well, you will not take leave through sicknesses and all. So you'll be having a, overall, you'll be having a very good life. Work effectively and efficiently. Whatever you're doing, whatever task you have taken in your life, as a student, as a faculty, as a family member, as a wife, as a sister, as a mother, all the tasks you'll be doing in a good way. Why? Because your emotions are balanced. Then what is emotional literacy? We are talking about high IQ literacy rate. We say, when we talk about Kerala, we say like they have 100% literacy. Okay, but what is the emotional literacy among people? So it is the ability to recognize, understand, and appropriately generate our emotions. That is emotional literacy. It is like how you perceive. It is like knowing the ABC of emotions, the alphabet and grammars of emotions. And that can be done. We always say like, we always see some people and we say like, how mature that person is acting. How good reasoning that person is having. Wow, that person is such a super problem solver. Wow, they see that our parents, they are raising their child so well. So we are always highlighting those qualities among people. So we are understanding the alphabets of grammar and vocabulary of their emotional life. That is emotional literacy. So what is the help of emotional literacy? When we become emotionally literate, we might be literate, we might be having a PhD, we might be having an LLB, we might be having an LLM, we might be having MD, we might be having everything. But we are having, that is IQ-wise literate. But when you become emotionally literate, you will be having a sense of identity. Yes, I know my limitations. I know my strength. Yes, I can handle my stress because I'm emotionally literate. I know the solutions for it. You'll be a good communicator. You'll not keep things to yourself. Communication is the key. You'll say like, yes, I have to convey. If I'm sad about something, I have to convey. If I'm happy about something, I have to convey. Group dynamics. As healthcare personnel, we are working in groups. We are given responsibilities. We are having departments. We'll always do well within the departments, because we are emotionally literate. Then conflict resolution. Whenever some problem happens, what we will do is like, we will respond to the situation. What is the problem with us is like, whenever there is a problem, we listen that problem to react rather than respond. What we have to do is respond. What is the difference between that? Is like when you listen something, listen patiently and then analyze and see what are the best possible answer, and then we give that answer. That is responding. But what do we do? When somebody is telling something, their problem, we are irritated and like a terrorist, we are taking a bomb with us. And then that bomb we take and we throw on them. Don't tell me that nonsense. I am not here to listen to your nonsense. Do that. That's it. We say that, isn't it? That is reaction. So we are not terrorists to carry time bombs. We are patient teachers, healthcare personnel, human beings. So what we have to do is like, we have to work on conflict resolution. Then managing feelings. Yes, when you are emotionally literate, you will manage your feelings. You manage the feelings of others also. Your kids, your students, your husband, your wife, everybody's emotions you will manage well. And you will be very good at decision making. Whatever decision you take, you will not regret about it. And whatever decisions have not come good also, you will have enough discussion on that and rationale on that. And ultimately, what will happen is like, it will empower your self-awareness. When it empowers your self-awareness, you know what are your pros and cons. What are your strengths and weaknesses? You know everything. And you can work on that and you can help others. You can understand yourself better also. So that is the help of emotional literacy. So the $1 million question, ladies and gentlemen, is, can EQ be enhanced? Yes, one of my slides said it. It said it can be enhanced. So how it can be enhanced? First is by age, isn't it? We always give due respect to age, isn't it? A person of 50 years of age, we say like, yes, he's seen more rainfall than me, isn't it? So we should give more respect to that person. He might have handled more such situations, isn't it? That's why he had changed his perspective. He might be having good knowledge about it. So age as a factor can help you enhance your emotional intelligence. The person you were at the age of 10 and the person you are at the age of 25 or 35 or 40 is totally different. Why? Because that emotional maturity has come to you. Second, experience. Yes, experience is said to be a best teacher, isn't it? Whatever faulty decisions you have taken in your life, whenever the same scenario comes back again, you are cautious about it. You say like, yes, yes, I will not do this mistake again. I'm not foolish now. I've become smart enough, isn't it? So that is how experience teaches you. That enhances your emotional intelligence. Third is by education. Why education is important? Because over a period of time, you know different theories, different concepts, different ideas, and you develop your bonding. You develop your ideas of emotional intelligence on that. It hardens your emotional intelligence. So education also helps. And finally, the most important thing, that is, it can be enhanced to training, which is a very good thing because we are not having time. We are having nuclear families. We are focusing more on the technological world. And there is one concept that says, yes, through training, we can change the behavior. We can idealize, we can make them idealize good qualities in life. We can make them empathetic. We can make them good leaders. We can make them handle good relationships. We can tell them how to handle their stress. All these virtues of human life or emotional intelligence can be enhanced through training. This is Daniel Goleman's model of emotional intelligence, which says that like when you are emotional intelligence, your self-awareness is good, your social awareness is good, your self-management is good, and your social skills are also good. So you can become an emotionally intelligent person. You can have a lot of empathy. Organization-wise, you can be a good leader. You can be a good relationship maintaining person. You can be a good understanding person. You can be a good person who can understand your feeling and the feelings of others. You can be evolving as an all-rounder as far as emotional skills are concerned. So today, in brief, let us discuss about some strategies where you can enhance your emotional intelligence. Since I have been given limited time, we cannot go on to the total training session or something, but I will give you certain takeaways to y'all. How we can inculcate those and we can be at least 90% positive person, emotionally intelligent person. Let us understand what are those emotional intelligence building strategies. Okay. First is self-awareness. Without knowing yourself, you cannot understand anybody else. Knowing yourself is the beginning of all wisdom. We are always saying we want to change the whole world. But the question is, do you want to change? That is the first question. We have to change ourselves. We have to understand what are the flaws in myself. Then talk about changing the whole world. So self-awareness includes recognition of our personality, our strengths and weaknesses, our likes and dislikes. Okay. Emotional self-awareness means being aware about your emotions and how they influence your thought and action. How my emotions are very important, how they can influence myself and other person also. That is emotional self-awareness. Having that is very important. We cannot react anywhere, anyhow. We are responsible people. We have certain responsibilities. So when we have responsibilities, we should understand our emotional balance and turmoils also. Now, why self-awareness is important? Because it helps you identify your strengths and weaknesses. Nobody is perfect. Nobody is Bahubali, isn't it? We have our own flaws, isn't it? We have problems in our life. We have like, okay, these are things I can do, these things I can't do. Okay, whatever things I can't do, I should work on that and I should make it my strength. That should be our goal. Second thing, it helps us set realistic goals. We cannot be haywire goals like I'll be buying the Burj Khalifa or something. We are putting realistic goal one by one. We are saying like, yes, I will do this first, then second is, third is, because I am oriented to reality. What are my limitations and what are my strengths? I know that. Helps to shed all the inhibitions. We are not nervous. We are not panicked to come on stage or to do something because we know, yes, this is my strength. I can do it. This is my weakness. I can do it. So that's how self-awareness helps us. Next, it helps us understand our own behavior. Most of the time, we fail to introspect. We fail to look into the mirror as to where we are lacking. We say like, we are fine. The problem is on that side. If relationship issues are there, my 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 10 points are good. His 10 points are not good. That's why he's bad. He's creating all the ruckus. No, it cannot be like that. You cannot clap with one hand. It requires two hands. So we have to understand. We have to sit across and talk like, where is the vehicle going haywire? Why these tires are not getting balanced? Then recognize other people's needs and feelings. Yes. Self-awareness will always help you understand your needs and the other person's need also. The more the high you are on self-awareness, the more understanding and capable person you'll become in your life. Then how you can build upon self-awareness? First and foremost is something called as SWOT analysis, that you must be knowing. I'm not stretching much on there, but what I'm saying is, like, it is a very important thing. Taking a piece of paper, dividing into four quadrants, writing your strength, writing your weaknesses, writing your opportunities, writing the threats, and then working on that, changing your weaknesses into strength and threats into opportunity. Do that, ladies and gentlemen. It really helps, because you know your limitations. Where is the problem? Why is these things happening? How can I can prevent those things? And you will evolve as a greater human being. Second, keeping a journal, writing a diary, your problems, your plan, your short-term goal after 3 months, after 6 months, after 1 year, what you can do. Because without plan, we cannot go anywhere. It will be just like a haywire journey. Whenever we want to go something from Surat, if we want to go to Ahmedabad, okay, we know we have to go to Ahmedabad, isn't it? We just cannot take some random bus and go. That is how we should be having a journal and having our plan for that. Writing down your goals and prioritizing them. What do you want first? What do you want second? This is a unique characteristic of emotional intelligence person. They always have this plan on hand. They don't keep plans in mind. Are mere dimag mein sab hai. Main ye karna chahti hu. I do this, I want to do that, I want to do that. No, it has to be on the paper. Then only it can be successful. Fourth is perform self-reflection. Self-reflection is a simple technique, yet very powerful technique. You stand in front of a mirror or a cupboard mirror in the evening, close the door and talk to yourself. See your reflection, your image, and talk about the whole day that has happened. Where I have gone wrong? What could I have avoided? What decision I have taken correctly? Analyze on that. That will help you grow as a human being. Do that. Self-talk is the most powerful tool for people who can't ventilate to others. We always say, you know, some people say, I am reserved. I don't want to talk to anybody. I don't like sharing my feeling. Then do self-talk. Ventilate to yourself in the mirror. When you see yourself in mirror, you'll be able to ventilate and you'll feel fresh about the whole thing. Then ask trusted person to describe you, not a person who will butter you and all. It should be a neutral observation and it should be a neutral thing. Ask that person to explain where I'm going right, where I'm going wrong. Ask them to describe you. That also will help you all as a good person. Self-awareness is equal to clarity in life. If you want clarity in life as to where you want to go, where you want to, what you want to do, what is my passion in life, why I'm here, all these things will be answered if you are clear about your self-awareness. It brings clarity in life. The first step towards high emotional intelligence is clarity in life. Second is communicate, communicate, and communicate. Emotionally intelligent person will always communicate well. See, no person is antaryami who can read your mind. There will be n number of things going in your mind, isn't it? How the other person will know? When you go home, if you are married, you have always have a complaint that my mother-in-law doesn't understand me. Mother-in-law has complained that her daughter-in-law doesn't understand me. And then what happens is, like, mother-in-law is going and telling the neighbors that daughter-in-law is like this. And daughter-in-law is coming to the college and telling all the colleagues that mother-in-law is like this. But the problem is, where is the problem? Problem is, y'all had to sit across the table and talk. Ventilate the feelings. Tell how you're feeling about the whole situation. That communication should have been very important. Most of the time, we keep it inside. And remember, this mind is like a pressure cooker. When you're keeping something in a pressure cooker, like rice and water, when do we know that the rice is done? When the whistle will come, when the steam will come. So whatever is cooking up in your brain, see that the whistle comes through your mouth. You talk about it. Okay. You talk to your fellow person. You talk to a trusted person. Then only the pressure will come down. If the cooker did not give whistle and steam, then the cooker would have blasted, isn't it? Then one fine day, the same thing will happen to you all. If you're not telling now, it is piling up, piling up, piling up. And one day this pressure cooker will bust. And we as human being has been given a fantastic quality, that is vocabulary. We know different languages. Use those languages. Talk to your related people. Talk to your trusted people. Ventilate your feelings. Ventilate. That's the only answer for pent up emotions. Ventilate. Third quality is cultivate optimism. Now, how to cultivate optimism? Should we take a fauda and go to the field and cultivate it? No. What I'm saying is, like, have an optimistic outlook in your life. What is very, very important? Because perspective matters. We can see anything and everything in a negative manner. Now vaccine has come, Covishield vaccine has come. A negative person might say like, this vaccine is not proper. The proper trial were not done. I will not take that vaccine. It is dangerous. Whereas USA vaccine is good. But optimists will say like, oh my God, within a short span of time, reputed institutes have made this vaccine. I should take the benefit of it. So that's the change in perspective, which is very, very important. Otherwise, we'll always become a negative person. And I, as I said, negativity attracts faster. Positivity doesn't attract that much. So we have to put more stress on positivity. Do that. Yes, it works. It works. It works. And then it is done. But negativity, that is dangerous. It will go like a wildfire to 100 people. People will not do that. So that's how people change their perspective. So we have to change our negative perspective to a positive perspective. How we can do it? To understand it better, we have to understand a concept called as learned helplessness. When we understand this concept, we'll understand why we become negative. This fantastic experiment was done by Martin Seligman. What he did was like he put dogs in the cage. He tied them to the chain, okay? And then he started his experiment by giving them shocks on their leg. Now, when the day one came and Martin Seligman started giving shocks on the legs of the dogs started howling. They wanted to break the chain and they wanted to run away. Next day, Martin Seligman came. He did the same experiment. He gave shocks on the leg. They wanted to break the chain, open the cage and run away. They were howling and shouting like anything. Third day when Martin Seligman came, he started giving shock. The dogs did the same thing. They started howling, crying. They wanted to break open the chain, run away. But fourth day when Martin Seligman came, he saw something different. He started giving shock. The dog lied down over there. He was just crying over there, but he was not moving. Fifth day when Martin Seligman came, he saw another amazing thing. He opened the cage. He left open the chain also. And he started giving shock to the dog. But you know, ladies and gentlemen, what the dog did? The dog lied down over there. He said, give me the shock. I will take that shock. But he was crying. Now, same thing happens to us, ladies and gentlemen. What happened to the dog? One day he tried, second day he tried, third day he tried, fourth day he registered on the mind that I cannot escape from here. I have to give up. I am a loser. I have to die over here. That's why he lied down over here, there, crying over there and give me shock. But ladies and gentlemen, on the fifth day, the opportunity was there. The cage was open, the chain was open, but yet the dog had registered in his mind that I'm a failure. I cannot run away from there. He did not run away from there. Ladies and gentlemen, once a failure, twice a failure, third time a failure, you are not a failure. Don't tattoo that on your mind. Fourth time, the opportunity might be there. Fifth time, the door might be open to you. What is in our hand is never say die, never giving up. And that is a universal quality of an emotional intelligent person. He will never give up very easily. He will try and try and try until it succeeds. So we have to cultivate that quality in us because we cannot give life that very easily. It's a precious gift that is given to us. And positivity is our asset. So now I will tell you all today the three secrets of optimism also. Now optimism is all about perspective. If a glass is given to you, you might say it is half full or half empty. Half full is an optimistic view. Half empty is the pessimistic view. So developing that pessimistic view is very dangerous to our health. But developing that optimistic view will always fetch us good dividends in life. Now let us understand these secrets which were given by Martin Seligman. Interesting secrets, pessimist and optimist. Now let us understand today like who is a pessimist and who is an optimist. Whether the people who are watching this are pessimist or optimist. Let us see. When a pessimist gets success and failure, and an optimist gets success and failure, how they view things. If you are a pessimist and you get success, you will say, it is temporary. Main sab mein successful nahi ho sakta. This is the only thing where I can be successful, man. I cannot be successful in all the things. But then optimist will say, it is permanent. I can be successful in anything. I can be successful in whatever task that is given to me. That is an optimistic view. When a pessimist gets success, he will isolate it. Yes, only in that area. I am a good speaker. That's why I can be a good speaker. But I cannot be a good organizer. I cannot be a good leader. That is the perspective a pessimist will have. But optimist will say, it is pervasive. I can be successful anywhere and everywhere. I can be good at gardening.
Sir, we cannot hear you.
Yeah, hello? Am I audible? Am I audible? Ah, okay. Yeah. Yes, pervasive. So optimist will say, like, I can be successful with anything and everything. I can be successful as a gardener. I can be successful as a teacher. I can be successful as a mother. I can be successful as wife. Everywhere I can be successful. When a pessimist gets success, he'll say, effort's irrelevant. You might have seen your colleagues also when you are studying and all. If they get full marks and all, they will say like, no man, that teacher likes me. That's why she has given me full marks. Actually, I don't deserve. I did not study also. I got marks by fluke. But an optimist will say, it is my personal effort. I have put effort for this. That's why I've become successful. But interestingly, when they get failure, when a pessimist gets failure and an optimist gets failure, it is totally different. And what is the difference? When a pessimist gets failure, he will say, it is permanent. I'm a failure everywhere. I went for gardening, I cannot water properly. When I went for studying, I'm not a good teacher. As a wife, I'm not a good wife. As a husband, I'm not a good husband. They will say like, main hi panoti hoon. That's a problem with me only. They will say permanently, I'm a failure. But optimists will say, this is temporary. I did not get success this time because I had my reasons. I could not go for that interview because I had 104 fever. But next time when I go for that interview, I will rock like anything. That is an optimistic view. Optimist when it gets failure, or pessimist when he gets failure, he'll say pervasive. Jahan bhi main jaao, wherever I go, I am a failure. Failure mere forehead pe hi likha hai. It is tattooed on my forehead that I am a failure. Wherever I go, I am a failure. But optimist will say, this is an isolated attempt. Here I could not do well because I had my own reasons. That is what an optimist will say. A pessimist when he gets failure, he'll say like, it is my personal problem. Main hi panoti hoon. I am the problem. When I was born, there was solar eclipse. I could not do anything well. I am actually a failure. I should not be here. I am a bhoj on this planet. I should not be living on this planet. That's how pessimists will say. But optimists will say, efforts are possible. Yes, I can bounce back. Whatever may be the debacle in my life, whatever may be the problem in life, I will bounce back successfully. This is one of the most important and peculiar quality about emotionally intelligent person. Never say die. Never give up being optimistic in life. So we have seen about self-awareness. We have seen about communication being an important aspect. And we are not now talking about optimism. Fourth strategy for emotional intelligent person, which we are having more problem nowadays, is emotional hijacking. Baat-baat pe, for small things, we bust, isn't it? What happens to us is like we bust like dynamite. We blast like a bomb squad. We blast like atom bomb, isn't it? What happens is like there is a lot of lacks of patience in us. What we do is like we take things to our heart very easily and then we react rather than responding. So what basically we have to do is we have to respond. There is a scientific circle to that. Whatever we see now or perceive things, it goes through your sensation. Then it goes to thalamus, it goes to cortex, and then it comes to amygdala. That is the process which is there of thinking. But what happens sometimes is like whenever you see something, it goes to thalamus, but it doesn't go to cortex. It directly comes to amygdala. And amygdala is the emotional headquarters. The role of amygdala is to bust, angry, suspicious. All these emotions will come up because cortex has the reasoning capacity. Cortex can't do that because your hijacking has taken place. Now in a day, recollect how many times your hijacking takes place. How many times you're angry? How many times you're bursting with people? How many times for petty things you're fighting? How many times you don't reason out? How many times you are not listening to the other party at all? That is hijacking. Count on that and become self-aware and lessen that weakness of yours into strength by becoming a understanding person who responds to things. That is how we can change ourselves. Okay. Then fifth strategy is being resilient. Life is not a bed of roses, isn't it? There are ups and downs. So we cannot say like that every day will be a rosy day. No, there will be ups, there will be downs. So what we have to basically do is like, we should have our emotions in control, and we should have that gut feeling that we can bounce back. As healthcare personnel, as human beings, as members of the society, we should have this quality. If Japan is never had this quality of bouncing back when Hiroshima and Nagasaki happened, they would have not have been that high-tech nation in the world. They had this resilience. They said, yes, we will bounce back. We will fight back. That quality you have to inculcate. An emotionally resilient person who's there, he'll always understand his own thoughts and emotions and his potential, what he can do. He responds to a situation rather than reacting. You are not a reactionary machine. You are not a robot. We have to respond to things as to why this problem has happened. Go to the root of it. Try to sort it out. He's always patient, understanding, and willing to adapt. Yes, many a times in a scenario, we'll have to adjust. An emotionally intelligent person will adjust also. We cannot be adamant and say like, this type of things only are needed for us. No, we can't do like that. An emotionally intelligent person will always adapt. He's high on acceptance and forgiveness. Yes, he'll accept the reality. Some things I've not got, something I've got. Some people have betrayed me, some have followed me. I will always go with forgiveness. That's what I'm saying. Start your day with forgiveness. Being resilient. This is an interesting quote which I loved about Nelson Mandela. The greatest glory in living life is not in never falling, but rising every time you fall. That's how. How many times can we get up? We have that guts to come back and fight back. That is the quality of resilience. So being resilient is also a very important quality of an emotionally intelligent person. So what makes a person emotionally resilient? Focus is on finding a solution. When we folks change our focus, are a problem, a problem, a problems are there, problems are there. No. What can be the solution for this problem? When we change our focus, we become resilient. Express his emotion in socially acceptable way. Just because I'm having tension, I cannot take alcohol or drugs and lie down on the roads, isn't it? What I have to do, I have to tell it to people who are trusted to me, and I have to make it express it in a socially acceptable way. Does not bottle up negative emotions. Yes, don't fill the jar of called as brain with your pent up emotions. Release those. City chodo. Usme steam aane do. Let the steam come. Let the whistle come. Let it come down. Okay. He's able to create and sustain long-term relationship. Yes, an emotionally intelligent person will always care for relationship. Rather than having an attitude, kaam ho gaya to I don't want anybody. Now the work is done. I don't want anybody. He will always see long-term relationship. He's not ashamed to ask help when they need it the most. There's no shame when you are emotionally down. When you know things are not falling properly, there's no shame. Directly go and ask for help with the counselor, with your loved one. Ask help. That is a quality of emotional intelligent person. Believes in sorting out conflicts through discussion. Even India, Pakistan tries to solve their conflict through discussion, isn't it? They have Lahore summit, they have Agra summit, where the prime minister come and talk. Now, in a family, can we not sit and talk about our problems? In a college, if we have differences, can we sit and talk about our problem? Yes, definitely, we can sit and talk about our problem. Be resilient. That is a quality which is very important. So today is the day. Now is the time. Ask yourself the question, how resilient are you? How resilient, how good you are as a fighter? That is a quality which is needed for us in this world today to sustain in a much healthy way. So my dream for all of you all is like, cultivate these areas of emotional intelligence. Know more about emotional intelligence. Work on your emotional intelligence. I would suggest one book also by Daniel Goleman, Why EQ Matters More Than IQ, and enhance your emotional intelligence and create a balance in your life. Now let us open our session for question and answer, if you all have any. I hope I was able to convey about emotional intelligence to you all, and you all had a very patient listening and understanding about it.
Well, we had an interesting and informative session this afternoon. Thank you, Mr. Vithoban Mahalkar, for enlightening us on understanding emotions, intelligence, and emotional intelligence.
The panel is open for question and answer session. Please put in your questions in the chat box of Zoom and in YouTube comment section. Here is the first question. How can we apply emotional intelligence in administrative practice?
Yeah, now as human beings, now emotional intelligence is a virtue of every human being, isn't it? It's not like just because you are in administration, emotional intelligence, just because you're a student, you should not have emotional intelligence. It is applied to everybody. Now, how we can do it in administration? Now, as an administration, we have different responsibility. We cannot be autocratic all the time, nor can we be democratic all the time. We have to have the meat of that. So what we can do is like, we can develop the quality of assertiveness. Now, what is assertiveness like? Telling your feeling or conveying your point without hurting the sentiments of others. It is a very important quality aspect of emotional intelligence where we develop assertive. An assertive leader can always convey his thing in a much, much productive way. So develop that. One thing is that. Second, having empathy about situation. How things would be if I was at the other side of the room. And then we can take decision. Sometimes because of the technicality or rules and regulation, we can't take the decision on emotional way. Then go by the rules and regulation, but convey, communicate in a much, much better way by sitting across the table. Because most of the time in administrative also, the problem happens because of miscommunication. What happens, like, we assume the things that the person will come to know. And when we have this assumption, the perception on that side might be totally different. And that's why the messages are not conveyed properly and conflict happens. So conflict can be prevented by having proper communication. If you're assigning any responsibility to anybody, call that person, give that responsibility. Be clear about the objective. Be clear about the outcome. That is what is important. This is what is accepted from you. I'm giving you this 15 days. This is assigned task to you. So you are clear in that rather than just haphazardly giving the task. That is also. Second thing, being administrative, a lot of stress will be there because targets have to be completed. And when targets have to be completed, what we can do is like, we can use the principle of administration, that is decentralization. When we decentralize and give tasks to different leaders over there in your department, what happens is like they give you the work done. And then you can analyze on that rather than taking all the things centralized and having the burden of it and crushing down under that burden. So overall, what is very important, like being an administrative, you need the quality of being a good leader, being good at relationship, being motivated, being handling your relationship well, handling your stress well, your feeling style should be proper because everybody is watching you and your output depends on how good you are as an administrator. So what I'm saying is like for an administrator also, emotional intelligence becomes very, very, very important aspects of their life. You can work on that and you can be a very good administrator in your life, not in your professional life, also in your personal life also.
The next question is from the participants. How can we manage our anger mood?
Manage?
How can we manage our anger mood?
Anger mood, what I'm saying is, yes. What I'm saying is like, there are different strategies for anger management and all. When I said like, whenever you are angry and all, when your emotional hijacking takes place, it takes place in a second. Okay. And then when, if we react to this, that what happens is like, we are creating harm to ourselves. There was an interesting study which was done on jailers across the world, or the people who are in jail. And they were asked like, what is the one thing that you regret? And most of the people had given a common reply. And then they said like, if only I had prevented that impulse at that time, when I was fighting, if only I had not removed that knife and stabbed that person, if only I had not removed that pistol and shot that person. So that particular time when that action happened is very, very important. So how do we control the anger? One thing is that by delaying your responses. What we can do is like, even if you don't like somebody telling you something, give it a date. You say like, yes, I've not liked this thing of yours. But what we'll do is like, we will meet after 1 hour or evening, I'll be talking to you. So when we delay this, what happens is like the pent up emotions which are there, they do come out and they settle down. And what happens is like that intensity of the crime that you would have committed by beating that person or having a rage could be prevented. Then over the period of time, that 1 hour which you have given to him, you think over it like, Should I beat him? No, I should not beat him. Then police will come and they will take me. Then there will be police complaint. I'll be in jail. So you become realistic about the things. That's the same thing I'm saying. Whenever you are angry, whenever you are having problem, whenever your pent up emotions come up, anger, you respond to the situation rather than reacting. Don't become an atom bomb. Don't become a terrorist to throw that bomb. Most of the time what happens is like, we want to prove our point. We can prove our point later also. It's not like there and there we have to prove our point. No, we can. There is something for us, time out, which we can give to us. We can say like, yes, I'm not in the mood to tell now. I will tell you at that particular time. Let's discuss it later. So what I'm saying is like, best thing will be by postponing your response to it, not reacting. That is how it is not easy, but it is not impossible. If you try doing it, most of the time what happens, we want to overpower that other person. Just imagine a scenario at home. What happens is like your sibling is fighting with you. The sibling is younger. So what do you want to prove? You want to prove your might and power. So whenever there is quarrel, you have a fight with him and then you beat him. And then you feel like you have won the battle. No, it's not like that. You could have solved it meticulously by sitting across, by acknowledging his problem also. Most of the time we don't acknowledge. We are in a hurry to prove our point. So what I would suggest is like, rather than reacting, respond to a situation.
The next question is it possible to have more or less emotional intelligence in different situations? For example, I might be calm at work, but more emotional at home. Is that a good or bad thing?
That's an interesting question. Yes, the emotional intelligence can vary, isn't it? It's a fluctuating term. As I said, it can be enhanced, it can go down. So what I'm saying, like, this is a common phenomenon. Since you are attached to your family, you will show a lot more emotional. And if the work is not exciting you, you're just coming for the sake of coming, then you will be emotionally labile, isn't it? You'll not show that much emotionality over there. So what I'm saying is like, all these factors contribute over there. How good is the working environment? How good are the colleagues? Okay, how good is the task that is given to you? So based on that, the emotionality can vary. But what is the quality of emotionally intelligent person? The quality of an emotionally intelligent person is like, he balances the emotion. Yes, my family is very good. I'm emotional over there. But when I'm at work, what I have to do is like, I have to give my dedication towards that work. Because that work is giving me something. That work is giving me recognition. That work is giving the money with which I can run my family. So I should devote myself to that work. So then that dedication comes. So the emotionality might decrease. It might be very high at home. It might be low at work. But what I'm saying, there will be no compromise on the quality which is done. There will be no compromise on whatever you're doing, because you will feel from inside. You'll be, again, I'm saying, you'll be self-aware about yourself. You know your strength. You know your weaknesses. Yes, this is my strength. I can use the strength at both the places, and I can be effective. So you will balance your family as well your work life. That will be a peculiar quality of an emotionally intelligent person.
The next question is, sir, is it very likely that we express ourselves in our situation? But sir, sometimes that emotions come out in a wrong way. We have some regret in heart, but we burst out in anger, which gives us a negative impact.
Yeah. So again, I was my slides, I think I was talking about that only. Two important aspects over here are like, self-awareness and communicating in the right manner. Okay. That is what is very important. Two things which are very important, and avoiding your hijacking. So now when you say like you bursted in anger and now you are having that guilt feeling, that means your hijack has taken place. You have already become a terrorist. You have thrown a bomb at somebody, isn't it? Now what we can do, again, I'm saying, see, in life, there is nothing impossible. Only the dead cannot be made alive, isn't it? But everything is possible, and we can start it. Best quality of an emotional intelligent person will be, he will start with forgiveness. If you want to say sorry to anybody, say when they are alive. If you want to forgive somebody, forgive when they are alive. If you want to patch up with somebody, patch up when they are alive. When they are not there, we'll be writing 2-3 pages of obituary, isn't it? Is it worth writing? No. When they are alive, let's take care of us. So for whoever has asked the question, I would tell them like, okay, you have done it. Okay, henceforth, what you do is like you respond to situation rather than reacting. Whatever situation has become tense, you take the initiative. Say sorry And what you do is like you patch up and start afresh. We are human beings and we have a limited time span, isn't it? 70 years, 75 years, 50 years. We don't know how many years we are over here. But no matter how many years we are over here, let's become productive, understanding and cooperating human being. That is the target which we can. Ego will not take us anywhere. Let us bury the ego today.
The next question. Sir, sometimes we are not wrong, but other person can't ready to understand our emotions, can't be ready to understand our emotions. So that time we have no words to explain. So what we will do at that time?
Yeah. So today I have not discussed about assertiveness in detail over here. Why? Because there was limited time. This is not a training session. In training, I take that everything. Okay. But what happens over here is like, I'm saying like, be assertive enough to tell whatever you feel. It might be good. It might be bad. But we have to convey that. Most of the time what happens is like, just because of the fear of losing that person, we don't tell these things to other people. We will always tell goody goody things. We will not tell the bad thing. But if you want a fellow person to improve, then we should always be telling the good things as well as the bad thing. There should be constructive criticism which is there. Now, when you have put across your point, you are telling about your things and the other person is not understanding it or is in no mood to understand it. Remember, you are emotionally intelligent enough to tell that. Okay. Now that he is not understanding it, his mind is not under your control. Is it under your control? No. His mind is not under your control. But whose mind is under your control? Your own mind is under your control. Be happy that you have conveyed whatever you wanted to convey. Now taking that or not taking that is that person's headache. His emotional intelligence should rise. He should be thinking about it. That will trouble him only. But if you are telling also and then taking the stress of that, then you are compromising on emotional intelligence. Emotional intelligence says what? You convey that point to that person and be happy that you have conveyed that point to that particular person. And I am now free of my pent up emotions that I have conveyed the right message, whatever I felt about. Be happy about it. We are not here to convince people or impress people. We are here to live our life in the most practical way. And that practical way is thinking rationally with emotional intelligence.
The next question. Though we believed ourselves to be an optimistic person, is it okay to cry out at certain things? Meanwhile, you respond, the response ends up in tears. Is it okay? Is that okay?
Absolutely, absolutely fine. Crying is the best emotion that has given to us, isn't it? And for females and all, it is an asset, isn't it? Crying. So what I'm saying is like, I'm not being a feminist over here. Biologically, it has been like that. So what I'm saying, like, make use of that, but don't you use it as a sword towards doing some harm to other person. But what I'm saying is like, crying is a normal emotion. Again, I'll remind you about that pressure cooker thing. Crying is the city, crying is the whistle, crying is the steam which is coming out, isn't it? Otherwise, the emotions would have pent up in and then the cooker would have blasted. So what I'm saying is like crying is absolutely fine. And it is crying is not a department only of females. I'm saying like if the male feels like crying also, you can howl and cry, no problem. It is like you are penting up your emotions. You are releasing the pent up emotions. Crying is absolutely fine. Tears coming out. See, when there is attachment to a particular thing, whenever you are much connected to a particular thing, the emotional outburst will be much more. So what I'm saying is like emotionally intelligent person will think rationally and will not keep much attachment. He'll be detached and connected. It is a tricky term, but what I'm saying is like, yes, I love my brother. I love my sister. But it is not like if something happens to them tomorrow that I will go mad. No. I am realistic also that nobody is over here to stay for a lifetime. Whenever we are there together, we should celebrate. Whenever we leave each other, then also we should live in the fond memories. That is what is very important.
Thank you, Mr. Vithoba Mahalkar.
It's a lot of interesting question. I was happy to answer those. Okay. And I'll conclude with the last slide of mine. That is like, what we have to take away from here is like, know yourself better. Very important, because we have not been knowing ourselves better. So aaine mein dekho, mirror mein dekho, see yourself in mirror and be a different person. Talk with your trusted person, whomever you trust, Communicate, communicate, and communicate. Tongue is a fantastic organ which is given to us, and vocal cords. Make use of it. Avoid emotional hijacking. बात बात पे bomb blast नहीं करने का. Just postpone your responses. Respond to things. Work on your skill and hobby. Whatever hobby you have, you are a painter, singer, whatever is there. Try to nurture that along with your hectic schedule also. That will give you much relief. Stay connected and share happiness. Without sharing happiness, you will not get happiness. This is an interesting story which I always tell towards the end, which is my favorite story. A father was giving a sermon in the church, and when he was giving a sermon in the church, he told all the people in the church, like, I have kept those balloons over there. To take those balloons, write your name over there on the balloon and throw it in the open hole which is there behind. So what they did was, like, they inflated the balloon, wrote their name over there, ran into the hall, and they dumped the balloons over there. Then the father said, now go and pick your balloon and come. Everybody rushed over there, and they were searching for their balloons. Where is my balloon? Robert is searching, Tony is searching, Cajetan is searching, Michael is searching. And in that process, they are bursting other people's balloons also. Then the father said, stop, my child. I will tell you something. What you do is, like, whenever you lift that balloon, see the name on that balloon and call out for that person. So then the exercise started. They lifted the balloon. Yes, Michael balloon was given. Robert's balloon was given. Tony's balloon was given. And within no time, everybody got their balloon. What is the summary of this story, ladies and gentlemen? That when we share happiness, happiness will come to you also. So when I gave Michael's balloon, Michael came with my balloon also. Isn't it? So when we share happiness, we do get happiness. And finally, the last line, believe that these two shall pass. Akbar and Birbal were talking, and Akbar asked Birbal, one statement you tell me where there is happiness also and sadness also. So then Birbal said, the statement is, these two shall pass. Ye waqt guzar jayega. Akbar asked him, like, how? Birbal said, if you are partying today and happy today, remember, ye waqt guzar jayega. These two shall pass. And if you are sad today, if you are broken today, remember, these two shall pass. Ye waqt guzar jayega. So always be positive, stay happy, do the best thing in your life and be successful. So last quote is, emotionally intelligent people don't do different things, they do things differently. And the only age that matters to them in their life is courage. Okay, so stay happy, stay positive, all the best. And thanks a lot for giving me this opportunity. It was indeed fantastic talking to all of you. Thank you, Jasmine, Jacob, for taking this initiative also for doing this session. I'm very happy about it. And thank you for your esteemed college for giving me this opportunity. You can follow me on Facebook and all. I have my Umo page also. I can give you feedback over there, yeah, interesting suggestions over there also. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Vithoba Mahalkar, for your precious time and valuable information you have shared with us. Now the time is yours, Mrs. Monica Sridhar.
It was a wonderful time of discussion. Thank you, Mr. Vithoba Narayan, for your lovely presentation. Now I hand over the time to Mr. Koteshwar for the vote of thanks.
In the onset, I would like to thank our speaker, Mr. Vithoba Narayan, for the wonderful way you have presented on understanding emotions, intelligence, and emotional intelligence. We are enlightened by the knowledge you shared with us. I would once again like to thank you for sparing your valuable time. I would like to thank our Honorable President and CEO, Dr. Srikakoli Elia, for your motivation and the support given to us. A special thanks to the organizing committee, the IT personnel, teaching faculty, and the staff who has put in a lot of efforts in planning and organizing, without whom this webinar would not have been possible. My special thanks to the entire virtual viewers who have patiently spent their time and for being a part of this knowledge-filled webinar session. Thank you. Shall we all close our eyes for the closing prayer? Let's pray. Divine Creator, Matchless Savior, we thank you so much, Lord, for this wonderful time that given to us. At this moment, we thank you so much for giving us your beloved son, Brother Vithoba Narayan Malakar, Lord. Thank you so much for your insight that you've given to him and blessing him with the utmost wisdom, Lord. As you have shared a lot of knowledge with us, how to balance our emotions, how to balance our intelligence, and how to be positive and share happiness to each other, Lord Father. Life is full of positivities. Life is full of opportunities, Lord. Let us have optimistic mind and let us share the good things so that life is a one-time journey, Lord Father. Be with us and guide us. Bless all the virtual viewers who are viewing this webinar. May you bless them so they can carry forward this information and put the end to ego this day, Lord Father. Bless them and guide them too. Bless the organizing committee. Bless each and everyone who are involved in this webinar, Lord. For you, all our sins and shortcomings, when thou comest in the clouds of heaven, please grant us place in thee. For all the few blessings, you pray in holy, mighty, matchless name. Amen.
Thank you, Mr. Koteshwar. Thank you, sir, Mr. Vithoba Narayan. We are grateful for you enlightening us regarding understanding emotions, intelligence, and emotional intelligence. We thank you all for joining and participating in this webinar. Please make sure to fill the feedback form, which is available in the chat box of Zoom, YouTube channel, Telegram, and in emails. You will receive your certificate in the next 4 working days. Thank you once again for joining us today. Look for more webinars from